If there's any series of games that has undergone massive changes over the last 16 years, Paper Mario takes the cake. While the first two titles were of the same formula and style, everything after that completely abandoned the conventions of the game to pursue some sort of novelty mechanics. To be frank, they got significantly worse. So today, I'm going to be discussing the first two Paper Mario titles. The Thousand Year Door, the second title in the series released on the GameCube, is widely considered to be the best in the series, as well as one of the greatest games of all time. I personally have always preferred the first game, but if you can't be objective about the things you like, you can never truly take a critical look at creative media. Why are the games so incredibly beloved? There's so much to them that it's really hard to pinpoint what makes them work. Who knows, maybe through discussion, we'll be the ones to convince Nintendo that the original style is worth trying again. Let's be incredibly clear. Back when the series still had a soul, the paper in Paper Mario was purely a reference to the aesthetic, with the first game using it for visual gags, and the second game pushing it a bit further to incorporate into minor mechanics. Paper was never supposed to be the core aspect or central element of the game. Rather, it was a vehicle to tell cute, fun, energetic stories with quirky, interesting characters, and a few epic bouts along the way. Now, to establish some background on my opinions and relationships with the separate games of the series, I feel it's integral to make my biases clear before I start this critical analysis. I find the first and second games to be thorough masterpieces. Beautiful games with immeasurable charm. The third game has a lot of strong narrative elements and platforming as well, yet it still lacked some core gameplay elements and legitimate tension that the first two titles had. Finally, Sticker Star and Color Splash need no introduction. These two games single-handedly fractured a devoted, loving fanbase that had existed for over a decade. With this understanding of the five, I'm pretty confident that I can defend my opinions on each of these titles with ease. As I stated previously, this video is primarily focused on the first two titles, so we're going to take a look at the mechanics for those games. Paper Mario and its sequel, The Thousand Year Door, are both RPGs featuring gaming's greatest as he attempts to save Princess Peach from numerous assailants, Bowser included. Mario will join up with many partners throughout both games, from Goombas and Koopas to Shadow Beings and Cloud People. One thing is for certain, and that's that Mario's entire group is a band of pure misfits. Even Lady Bo, with all of her majesty, is still a short-tempered, spoiled ghost. Whether it's traversing chapter by chapter through dungeons and interesting dynamic overworlds, or battling enemies in a creative turn-based combat system, Paper Mario and Paper Mario the Thousand Year Door will keep you thoroughly entertained. The combat of both the first and second game are essentially gleeful, fantastically simple, and yet incredibly expandable. Obligatory spoiler warning here, as I am going to be getting into some late-game content during this discussion. Paper Mario 64 has a cute tale of a much more vibrant and colorful Mushroom Kingdom. From villages to deserts and much more, each corner of this world is, again, vibrant with its own culture, society, and set of emotions. The game is an incredibly deep in narrative, with the first few chapters lacking any real story at all. That being said, when you first arrive in Boo's Mansion, you realize that Mario is taking a slightly different role in this title. Saving Peach is the plan, but in order to do so, Mario and friends become the fix-alls for a series of unique problems. Areas like the Gusty Gulch show that despite the fact that they don't all live in economic harmony, the Boos have an incredible loyalty to their queen. It's silly, but a lot of fun. Tubba Blubba, a villain who was once an underdog for these villainous ghosts, is now a boss of massive proportions with a coveted secret to his invincibility lurking in the shadows. The evil Huffenpuff later on in the game has removed the sun from Flower Fields, and now it's up to Mario to destroy his evil machine and save the saddened sun, restoring glory and joy to what is, in my opinion, one of the most beautiful settings in the game. Even the underlying story that lurks in the background is simply charming. Stars, who can't have their wishes granted because of Bowser's thievery, Peach sneaking around the castle and finding out information to help Mario. Despite each area having their own separate elements, there's also the joyful element of having a story that carries throughout, as well as some incredibly epic foreshadowing. Fast forward to the Thousand Year Door, and we've got a far more complex narrative, with history of a treasure that hides behind a gate, and yet another princess capturing. This time, our boy Bowser isn't the man in charge, rather the evil X-Knot army has become the focal point. And it works! Mario's team is so integral to the story in a way that they simply weren't in the first game. A lot of the first game's allies were only there to fulfill mechanical purposes, but in this one, there are so many active dynamics between Mario and his friends. You have Goombella, a witty college student trying to make her name, Koops, a Koopa who lacks courage and wants to join you in battling a dragon, Madame Flurry, a shamed actress with upsetting endowment who travels with Mario to feel beautiful again. Very weird character. Then you have a Yoshi that Mario pretty much raises while he's in the Glitz Pit, and Vivian, who I'm going to give her own section later on in the video. Finally, Bobbery is mourning the death of his wife and is afraid to return to sea. You heard me correctly. It's a bomb whose wife got sick. How does that even work? What happens to their bodies once they explode? But unlike the last game in the series, this one has far more than just interesting heroes. The villains are also incredibly characteristic and unique in a way that I found to be very compelling. The best example of this would be the Shadow Sirens, who are three evil sisters that you fight at numerous points throughout the game. There's a sort of abusive interaction between Beldum and Vivian. Vivian is constantly the butt of jokes and treated poorly, likely as a result of jealousy, since she's the only one who doesn't look like a Wizard of Oz ripoff. The game establishes some strong sympathy for Vivian early on, which makes you start to root for her well before she becomes your partner. And that's where I get into Vivian as a character, because she's easily the most complex and interesting character in the game, because she's had all of her values handed to her. Everything that she cares about because she was told to. She meets Mario at an incredibly vulnerable time, but doesn't know his name because of a spell by the evil Duplis. Mario does an act of kindness for her, retrieving a bomb that was meant to destroy him because he sees her crying. You know, Mario, the guy who in the history of this franchise has had as much personality as the pipes he cleans. It's notable that these characters are a strong vehicle for our silent protagonist to express some feelings for once in his life. These are just small examples of elements in an overarching narrative. It can also be seen from the relationship between Peach and Tech, but I hate that part of the game, so I'd rather not talk about it. It's a very weird budding romance. Then, similar to the first game, there are the individual story arcs for each chapter. Because everyone needs some help. There are dragons invading towns, an evil underground conspiracy in the Glitz Pit, murder mysteries on the XS Express, and much more. This is only driven home by the brilliantly written NPCs and masterfully designed environments. Also, I can't leave the story behind without talking about perhaps one of the most interesting aspects of the Thousand Year Door. Bowser, who is constantly tailing behind everyone trying to figure out what to do to get his hands on the Crystal Stars, and the treasure by extension. After getting his time to shine in the last game, complete with an epic speed metal final battle theme, it was a good time to let Bowser take a back seat to a more intimidating villain, like a legit Demon Queen. Because this is an RPG, a lot of the game feel elements don't really come from the mechanics, but the story and aesthetic. And I just told you how Paper Mario excels at that by bringing everything to life in a nearly unprecedented way. The scale of the world is massive, building background and foundation that Mario has never had. With elements like wishes and space and guardians being the building blocks for the first game, and evil organizations all around the world and in space worshipping demons in the second title, I mean, even Super Paper Mario, despite not being integral to this video, establishes the existence of multiple dimensions. Theoretically, these games open the door to explain an infinite amount of scenarios in the Nintendoverse, including Smash Bros. But I don't want to get ahead of ourselves. Paper Mario is huge, but yet it's not overwhelming. It's expansive and emotionally gripping, but not melodramatic or excessively suspenseful. The playful atmosphere of Mario is still here as it should be, but it's been brought to a level that we've never seen before. Unfortunately, if the games keep straying away from the original content and characters as they've done with Sticker Star and Color Splash, this may be an element that we never see again. I could go on forever about how thrilling combat is in these games, but despite its wonder, and the fact that it's one of the largest aspects of the game, there's really not too much for me to break down. It's a pretty basic turn-based system with a few action elements thrown in there to keep you on your toes, but the game teaches you how to play in a very straightforward way. It's not like Super Monkey Ball, right, which is a far more action-oriented title, and the level design is intended to show you the ropes. This is an RPG, so all the tutorial elements are pretty text-heavy, and they get the job done. There's really no shame in that. That being said, exploration in Paper Mario 1 and 2 is incredibly unique, as the partners you travel with often have key roles to play in getting you from point A to point B, and so on. In the Thousand Year Door, Mario gains some extra abilities of his own, taking advantage of the paper aesthetic to turn into an airplane, a boat, and just a completely flat man. This gives players the opportunity to see every crevice of this unique rendition of a beloved world. Perhaps the strongest aspect of these games is their masterful understanding of atmosphere. These titles push the ideas to the limit, creating fantastic papercraft and cardboard environments. The beauty is insurmountable, and combined with a stellar soundtrack, there's simply no topping it. This is existent in Thousand Year Door with its beautiful final area and a few of the scenic level designs throughout the game, but the first game has it down to a science. In the first Paper Mario, there's this really strong use of environmental shift, where the ground and sky change almost instantly as you transition between certain connected areas, and music fades out so a different track can step in. It lacks the screen transition like most areas in the game, and it's a real power play, dictating emotion on a complex level. A very good example of this is the transition between Toad Town and the beautiful Shooting Star Summit. It shows a real thorough sense of majesty, and is perhaps the most influential area in the game's entire narrative. With it being so close to home, yet so different from every other area of the game, you can't help but feel differently as you approach that space. The overwhelming size of some areas of the game are also incredibly potent in influencing the story's impact on you. My favorite example is the ever-beautiful Shiver Mountain, which not only has an incredible sense of wonder, but also a beautiful track that plays when you enter the area. You can feel the history flowing throughout this place, and the visuals simply complement it with everything being so reflective and ancient feeling. It compels you to keep moving forward. I started to write this as an analysis of the mechanics of these titles, but Paper Mario is a series that always gets me talking about atmosphere and environment instead. Just as I start to think about it, many memories, experiences, and emotions flood back as I sort of get a very vivid visual of the type of experiences you have when you play through these games. In my last video on Super Monkey Ball, I described how games are only truly great when they influence the way you feel. I don't think I've ever played a game that does that as well as the first two Paper Mario titles. Unique and lively characters across the board, a world with a living, breathing culture, and a reason to explore with substantial tension, and yet also have a truly fun and exciting adventure. These are the elements that will cement Paper Mario and Paper Mario the Thousand Year Door as some of the greatest games of all time. Thank you everybody for watching yet another one of these lengthy critical analysis videos. I seem to really be getting a knack for this sort of thing. If you're interested in more discussion-based content, feel free to check out the Super Monkey Ball video that I did previously. Otherwise, you can also check out the Mustafa's Game Room podcast, where we discuss many topics around the game industry, genres, and styles of development. In the meantime, thank you again for watching, and come back soon for more from The Game Room.